Bible. I believe it's the infallible, incorruptible word of the living God. I believe I am whom he says I am, and I can do what he says I can do. I open up my heart this day to receive from God's holy word, and I declare it will profit and prosper my life. Faith comes and increases in me as a result of God's holy word. In Jesus' name, amen. While we're still standing together, let's turn in our Bibles to Exodus chapter 3. Exodus chapter 3, and I want to encourage those of you who are joining us online, whether you're members of the Kingdom Faith family that could not make it today, or you are just someone who's aware of our ministry, please join us. Grab your Bibles. Let's turn to Exodus chapter 3. We're going to read quite a number of verses together, verses 15 to 22, and then we'll get started. Exodus chapter 3, verses 15 to 22. All right, we'll go for it. 3, 2, 1, go. Moreover, God said to Moses, thus you shall say to the children of Israel, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial to all generations. Go and gather the elders of Israel together and say to them, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob, appeared to me, saying, I have surely visited you and seen what is done to you in Egypt. And I have said, I will bring you out of the affliction of Egypt to the land of the Canaanites, and the Hittites, and the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites, to a land flowing with milk and honey. Then you will heed my voice. And you shall come, you and the elders of Israel, to the king of Egypt. And you shall say to him, the Lord God of Hebrews have met with us. And now please let us go 3 days' journey into the wilderness that we may sacrifice to the Lord our God. But I am sure that the king of Egypt will not let you go. No, not even by a mighty hand. So I will stretch out my hand and strike Egypt with all my wonders, which I will do in its midst. And after that, he will let you go. And I will give this people favor in the sight of the Egyptians. And it shall be when you go that you shall not go empty-handed. But every woman shall ask of her neighbor, namely of her who dwells near her house, articles of silver, articles of gold, and clothing. And you shall put them on your sons and on your daughters, so you shall plunder the Egyptians. Praise the name of the Lord. Anybody ever heard this expression, when the blind leads the blind, they will both fall in the ditch? This expression has become one that is very, very meaningful to me lately, particularly looking back at what many of us have experienced in the year 2020. Many people fell into ditches because many could not see ahead of time what was going to happen. As a matter of fact, I dare to say that even some who were supposed to be leaders also couldn't see clearly. And hence, it was the blind leading the blind. Everybody just kind of hoping, God, we just hope we get through this. But not seeing clearly enough to be able to make the right decision. I want to start this morning by asking a number of questions. And I want you to listen to these questions very carefully. How much did you foresee before the beginning of 2020? Is there anybody here who would agree with me that this has been a year like you have never known before? All of my life, a few decades now. But did you foresee the events of 2020? How much of it did you foresee at the beginning? Another question, how far ahead can you see now? Do you know what you should be doing to prepare for what is ahead of you in 2021? I ask those questions to create a bit of tension in your heart, because this morning I want to talk to you about the importance of seeing ahead and the need to be well prepared for what is to come. I've titled today's message, The Power of Foresight. Somebody say, the power of foresight. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray for your help. Holy Spirit, help me. Anoint me to minister this word powerfully. And I pray that every son and daughter that is listening can hear, understand, and profit as a result of this word today. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. You may be seated. Praise the name of the Lord. You will all remember 31st of December 2019, the Lord brought a word. I did not know I was speaking as a prophet when I came and I began to speak about the need for divine insight for kingdom advancement. That was the message, 31st of December 2019. And the Lord led me to start talking to you about eyesight, insight, and foresight. I remember sharing with you that eyesight is the ability to see. Insight is the capacity to gain an accurate and deep understanding from what you see, while foresight is the ability to predict what will happen or is needed in the future. So when we look more closely at this word foresight from God's perspective, we would see that in the scriptures, our Heavenly Father has always desired for us, His children, to be in the know. He's always desired for us to have foresight. It has always been God's will, not just for us to know what has happened in the past or what He is doing today, but He also wants us to know the events that are about to take place and what He intends to do about it. Because let me tell you what hit us the most in 2020. Many children of God had no clue how to respond to what began to unfold. And many of us leaders, ministers, were confused about what God was saying or doing about it. I thank God for all that the Lord gave us in terms of clarity and how it has helped us here at Kingdom Faith Ministries. But the truth be told, it's always been the desire of the Father that His children know in advance. I can give you a few examples in the Bible. For example, in Genesis 15, we read of the encounter that Abraham had with Heavenly Father God. When God starts giving Abraham foresight about the things that are to come, even things that were going to happen more than 400 years later. Remember how Abraham was told about his descendants that will be called Israel, and his descendants will be a nation, and a time would come when they would go into a land and they will be held captive for 400 years. Go read Genesis 15. It was there. Foresight, 400 years in advance. In Judges chapter 13, we read the story of an angel visiting Manoah and telling Manoah and his wife about the child they're going to have called Samson. And then they gain foresight about Samson and the life of Samson and how the Samson is going to have supernatural strength and be a deliverer for Israel. All through the prophetic books, we see more and more of God showing His children insight, foresight. For example, Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 9 verse 6 prophesies, "For unto us a child is born, for unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder. And of the increase of this government there will be no end. His name will be called Counselor, Wonderful, Almighty God." We shared that around Christmas time. But one thing I want you to take note of was that Isaiah was given foresight about this event over 600 years before it happened. So God loves to give His children foresight. Now, we looked at an opening text, Exodus chapter 3, verses 15 to 22. And there you could see God giving Moses foresight. God was speaking to Moses privately and letting him know what is about to unfold. And to the extent that He gave him details. Let me share five of those details with you very quickly. Number one, God made Moses aware that the elders of Israel will eventually listen to him and follow him. Number two, He made him aware that Pharaoh will initially be stubborn. Pharaoh will be hard-hearted. Number three, but God wants to smite Pharaoh and Egypt and then bring them to their knees. Number four, that the children of Israel will eventually be free from slavery and bondage. And number five, that when the children of Israel come out, they're going to come out with great riches. Now, there's so much more in that passage we read, but just those five alone. Somebody say foresight. Now, how much difference did it make for Moses to have been given so much information ahead of the events that took place in Egypt? Just think about it for a moment. Because Moses had foresight and he knew ahead of time what challenges he would face, and that if he persevered, he will have the breakthrough that God promised. See, one of the important ingredients that goes with foresight is faith. If God gives you foresight and allows you to see what is about to happen, then all you need is to have faith to stand on his word. As a matter of fact, I dare to say that Moses was destined to have good success because God already told him what was going to happen. Now, yet, Moses had a part to play in all of this. In other words, when you have foresight, someone has rigged it in your favor to make sure you have good success, and the only way you can fail is if you self-sabotage yourself. You're the only one that can make you fail. Because everything has been set up in your favor and you've been told what the end result is. Someone say foresight. Let's look at the benefits of foresight. Four benefits very quickly. Number one, and I want you to write this down. And if you're listening to me from home, please write this down as well, because you're going to need this in preparing for 2021. Benefits of foresight. Type it with your smart device. Keep it somewhere where you can look at it over and over again. Number one, you can foresee what is going to go wrong and thus guard against losses. Write it down. You can foresee what is going to go wrong, and so you can guard yourself against future losses. Number two, you can foresee the opportunities to prosper even from impending crisis. So stuff will happen. Some people will see it as crisis, but it will be your opportunity to prosper. Why? Because you have foresight. Number three, you can plan effectively to make progress while others are failing. While others are struggling because they lack foresight. Remember what I said at the beginning? The blind kept leading the blind. We all kept falling into the ditch. Because when a leader can't see, the leader can't direct you correctly. So leader falls into the ditch, you fall into the ditch. And if leaders are scared to lead, they just go on furlough. And they just say to everybody, just take a break. Because the leader is saying, I really don't know what's going on here. I really am not sure I can lead you anymore. So let's just shut down the church and let's all go on furlough. And let's just hope and pray that we'll come out of this alive. But every one of us children of God are supposed to be leaders, because the primary assignment we've been given is to disciple all nations. Matthew 28, verse 18 and 19. Yes, some of you were laughing because you thought, oh yeah, that's the pastor. Mm-mm. Not just the pastors, every one of us. We are the light of the world and the salt of the earth. When there's darkness around us, it's a reflection that we're not shining our light. And if your colleagues at work who don't know God says, but what's going on with this whole COVID thing? What do you think is going to happen? You as a child of God, with your big Christian badge that you wear to the office, you should be able to give some light. Mm-hmm. Somebody say, ouch. Yeah, you were excited when it sounded like it was about pastors. Someone say foresight. Number four, you do not have to waste time and resources on the wrong ventures. Exodus chapter 5, verses 1 to 8. Please write it down. Moses gathers the elders and goes before Pharaoh. And Moses tells Pharaoh in verse 1, let my people go, that they may hold a feast to me in the wilderness. Verse 4, then the king of Egypt said to them, Moses and Aaron, why do you take the people from their work? Get back to your labor. And Pharaoh said, look, the people of the land are many now, and you make them rest from their labor? So the same day Pharaoh commanded the taskmasters of the people and their officers, saying, you shall no longer give people straw to make bricks as before. Let them go and gather straw for themselves. And you shall lay on them the quarter of bricks which they made before. You shall not reduce it, for they are idle. Therefore they cry out, saying, let us go and sacrifice to our God. So Pharaoh gets hard-hearted and refuses to listen to Moses and Aaron. Now, how well did foresight help Moses? Because he had foresight from God, this will happen. He will be hard-hearted, and it will be my opportunity to whoop his behind. I've wanted to deal with these people. They've been worshiping false gods, idols all this time, and they put their faith in all these idols. I will give them a plague. Each plague will represent the idols that they worship, and I will prove to them that their idol that looks like a frog, their idol that they think is the one that gives them water, will not be able to turn blood back to water. The idol that tells them that this is the one they worship for good crop failure, I will see what that false god would do when locust eats up all of the crop. And if you really study closely, all the plagues were direct challenge against the gods in Egypt at the time. And God proved all the way to the last one, when the firstborns were dying, that the gods that the Egyptians were worshiping were absolutely useless. In that same chapter 5, by the time you get to verse 20, 21, the people respond to Moses. The Bible says, then as they came out from Pharaoh, they met Moses and Aaron, who stood there to meet them. And they said to them, let the Lord God, or let the Lord look on you and judge you, because you have made us abhorrent in the sight of Pharaoh and in the sight of his servants, and you have put a sword in their hands to kill us. So the very people, Mr. Prophet, that you are sent to go deliver, they can turn against you. But foresight, somebody say, but foresight. But foresight, God had already prepared Moses and told him what will happen. When you read between Exodus chapter 8 to Exodus chapter 11, you'll read of so many of these plagues. One key thing I want you to take note of was from Exodus chapter 8, God said to Moses, none of these plagues from now on will affect my own covenant children, the Hebrews, neither will it affect the land of Goshen where you live. So guess what was happening? The children of Israel were progressing while others were failing. Locusts came, ate everybody else's crop. The Egyptians didn't touch the crop of the Hebrews. Disease came, killed the animals of the Egyptians, while the Hebrews were fine. As a matter of fact, by the time you get to Exodus chapter 12, you would see the importance of having foresight so that you don't waste any time. Somebody said, don't waste time. You don't waste time or waste resources when you have foresight. Because they have foresight, for example, how many people know that if God has already spoken, I'm getting you out of here, nobody's going to say, oh, let's go irrigate the ground, let's plant new seed that is going to yield fruit next year. Others will be doing it. They don't have foresight. Investing in the wrong thing, wasting their time and energy on something that will not bear fruit. But when you have foresight, you don't waste time. As a matter of fact, in Exodus chapter 12, when you look at verse 11, by the time Moses was giving them instruction as they ate the Passover, he said, and you shall thirst, you shall eat it, with a belt on your waist, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hands. So you shall eat it in haste. It's the Lord's Passover. Why, guys, we have no time to fool around. God is going to deal one more blow to the Egyptians. Then they're going to say, get out of here. So you guys, make sure you have your clothes on, you have your belt, you have your sandals while you're eating this meal, this dinner, this Passover. Because guess what? Early hours of the morning, we're getting out. And then when you get to verse 35 of that same chapter 12, The Bible says, now the children of Israel had done according to the word of Moses, and they had asked the Egyptians for articles of silver, articles of gold, and clothing. And the Lord had given the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians so that they granted them what they requested. Thus, they plundered the Egyptians. Somebody say foresight. God said, you will gather the elders, you will tell them. Then the elders will follow you. They would listen. Well, there will be challenges along the way. Even Pharaoh will be hard-hearted. But don't worry. I'm going to whoop him really bad. When I'm done, then you are going to find out that you'll be free to go. But before you go, make sure you tell all the people. Go to the madams, all the madams that they served, and say, madam, you know that jewelry you were wearing the other day when Pharaoh had a ball? You know that one that had a stone? Yeah, can I have that one? And you know the other one you wore when Potiphar was having a gig? Can I have that one too? And you know, and that they would give you everything you ask for. They use the expression borrow. Who borrows their jewelry out? To the state of being plundered. The Bible said they were plundered. It meant everything of value they had, they gave it to the Hebrews. Everything of value. I know sometimes when we look at the Bible stories, we don't really get a good picture. Just think about the fact that it was just earrings alone that they put together to melt to build the golden calf. How much earrings was necessary to build a calf that they would worship? And they still had enough gold left to still go build the tabernacle. So when we say plunder, we're not talking about one or two earrings here. He said, put it around your children. I'm talking about bling bling all over everybody as they're coming out of Egypt. They're coming out with blings everywhere. There's all kinds of bracelets, all kinds of gold. I'm serious. This was serious favor here. I know while sharing the story of Egypt, it sounds like a nice story, but I want to bring it home to you. I want to talk to you about 2020. You know, the year 2020. Anybody think you remember 2020? The year 2020. And you hear so much about 2020, how much it's been a horrible year. See, depending on who you're listening to and what news you're listening to, you know, how 2020 has just been horrible. How 2020 has been a year many people have lost their jobs and the businesses have closed down on the high street and it's been so horrible and people have had this and had that. But do you know that's not the story for everybody? Foresight made the difference. Now, I shared with you four benefits of foresight. Let me share with you again in a practical sense things that have happened in 2020. I want to talk about those who benefited from foresight in 2020. Please listen. Number one, they foresaw what was going to go wrong and they guarded against losses. Good example. The Chinese have suffered the least level of casualty of COVID-19. You know why? Particularly in the UK, I checked the statistics of COVID-19 deaths in the UK by ethnicity. The Chinese is 0%. It means the number of people is so little that it does not even go up to 1%, so it is insignificant. Who were the first people to know about the virus? Who were the first people to buy all the PPE equipment that was available on the world markets? Who were the ones who were the first to lock up a whole province, shut it down from the rest of the country, while they opened the international airport so that the rest of the world can have a little bit of it? See, when people have foresight, it depends whether they're good in their hearts towards God or they're not good. But foresight can be very, very dangerous too. Many businesses and corporations move to online operations on time to avoid financial losses that was experienced by the others. You see the businesses that have shut down on the high street? They had no foresight. They couldn't see. It was blind CEOs, leading blind COOs, leading blind CFOs, leading blind senior managers, and everybody blind together fell into a pit. Because those who had foresight had moved all the operations away from what needed to be a day-to-day, we've got to go to the office to do it. And they were ahead in online meetings, online work, remote working, they had foresight. So they guarded themselves against losses. They foresaw the opportunities to prosper from impending crisis. Those who had foresight. You see, there are many new millionaires and billionaires that have emerged this year, 2020. Actually, a record number of new millionaires and billionaires. I can see your facial expression. Some of you are looking at me like, can that be true? Go and Google it up. Whenever there's crisis, it's always opportunity for those who have foresight. Somebody say foresight. You know the reason why new millionaires and billionaires emerged from recent global economic calamity? Because they had foresight. Mm-hmm. Very simple. You know, money never leaves the earth. Not one piece of gold has ever left the earth. When you hear about the worst of the worst recessions and the worst of the worst economic calamity, you know what? It's the people that lost it that are shouting and screaming. But it's gone into the hands of somebody else and they're usually quiet. They don't talk. Recently, I listened to a new publication with regards to new century billionaires. Do you know what century billionaires are? You need to have over $100 billion to be a century billionaire. So on ALOX, they were listing the new ones because of the money they've made in 2020. Guess the name of one of the new ones. Elon Musk. Mr. Tesla. Mm-hmm. See, there's some big boys that have been there before. Jeff Bezos. While many are crying, those who have foresight are laughing. Let me tell you how they prospered from the impending crisis. The wise investors, they dumped all of their stock of corporations that were destined to suffer. They had foresight. I was listening to an analyst the other day, and he was talking about how they've gone to look at what the top investors have done. And they traced what some of them did in the early part of this year. One of them was Warren Buffett. They discovered that Warren Buffett dumped all airline stocks he had. Every single stock in every airline, he dumped it all. Guess what else he dumped? All the stocks he had in banks. So pay attention to that one, because those who have foresight, they see something, they know something. Dumped bank stocks, then dumped all the stock. You know what I mean by dump? Sold all his stock in restaurants. All restaurant stock. What did he know? And anybody who knows Warren Buffett very well, for many years, he's been very anti-precious metals. Warren Buffett will always say, oh, no, gold. No, I don't touch gold. Guess what he bought in 2022? Gold stocks. So somebody knows money is either about to fail or is failing already. See, when people change their money into precious metals, it's an indication of something. So I said to you, I said, many benefited because they had foresight. They planned effectively to make progress when others were beginning to fail. China was the first to do lockdowns, and they were the first to come out of lockdowns and get the economic machinery back in place. When everybody was still talking about how do we come out of lockdown, they were out. Every other part, apart from the Wuhan province, was out. Industries that opened, they had continued working. The online Goliath, I call them the online Goliath or the tech Goliath. See, they call them tech giants. I call them tech Goliaths because I don't really like them. Most of them, their heart is not for the kingdom of God. And they have profited at the expense of many lives being lost recently. So I call them tech Goliaths because I'm prophesying that God is going to raise Davids that is going to take them down, and all these billions that they have taken is going to come back into the hands of the children of God for the advancement of the work of God on the earth. That's why I call them tech Goliaths. See, the tech Goliaths ensure that all the logistic operations, including cargo flights, distribution centers, remained operational throughout COVID. Amazon here in Milton Keynes never shut down for one day. And people are on shift 24 hours a day. Did any of you miss your Amazon deliveries during lockdown? Somebody say foresight. Mm-hmm. You know what it takes to put together that level of logistics? Do you know what it takes to get logistics to the point where I can boast to you that if you order today on Prime, we'll deliver to you tonight. If you order it in the morning, we'll deliver it tonight. Do you know what is involved? I studied chemical engineering. My master's degree was in manufacturing management. I learned a lot about how to move things quickly on the conveyor belt, how to take a process. If Pastor Sif was here, he's a chemical engineer as well, he'll be laughing. We learned things like how to get process to go quicker. Those are the kind of stuff I was learning in my postgraduate. So there's a lot involved with the logistics of saying, order today, we can deliver tonight. Or order today, we deliver it tomorrow. Regardless of where that thing is. The operations continued. Why? Because they had foresight. Let's not even talk about who knew about this and who was involved and who was not. Let me tell you more about foresight. Zoom. Anybody had a Zoom account early this year? Anybody had the account, free account? Remember how it was free? And they pulled millions of us in because it was free. And we all enjoyed it because it was free. Oh man, I can have a video meeting with my buddies and it's free. We only have to endure the 40 minutes cut off. But when COVID hit and every company needed to do meetings, how many of us have now paid for subscription? Be honest, put your hand up, put your hand up. Don't act. Do you know what has happened? In the month of February, the Zoom shares was $80 per share, approximately $80. By October, it had hit an all-time high of about $500 per share. That's more than six times in growth. So imagine if you had foresight, and that money that you left with the pension, and they will tell you you get 2% when you're 65 years old. That money you've left, if you are taking £10,000 of that money and put it on Zoom in February, you would have had £60,000 in October. Somebody say foresight. Mm-hmm. So that's why the Lord has me preaching this message. Because the Lord wants you to know about the power of foresight. See, there is another word to do with sight that we use. We call it hindsight. So hindsight means look back and say, if I knew then what I know now. Meaning, you and I cannot stay the way we've been. We can't continue. The Bible says it so clearly. Way back then, 2,000 years ago, Jesus was saying, for the children of this world are wiser than the children of the kingdom. That can still not be true today. Yes, we will praise. Yes, we will worship. But we also need to be smart. And guess who are the ones who are supposed to have foresight? Who are the children of the one who knows 100% everything that will happen before it happens? The one who could tell Abraham 400 years ahead, this is what's going to happen. The one who could tell Isaiah, prophesied now, it's going to happen 600 years time. And that one is your father and my father. And yet, we were blind leading the blind in 2020. Most of us are testifying and celebrating that we kept our job. But many have become millionaires and billionaires and century billionaires. Do you know how much Mr. Bezos has made, has grown his net worth this year? Over $70 billion. The net worth of one man. While you spend hours every day playing on Facebook, a 30-something-year-old boy made over $40 billion. The growth of Facebook in the income they made this year. His own personal net worth. Zuckerberg's net worth has gone up by about $40 billion. I bet he does not even spend time on his own Facebook. Mm-hmm. I tell young people, I know sometimes it sounds like, oh yeah, here comes these old people, they don't know what they're talking about. You keep fooling around with social media and you'll be broke. Because the people who put that thing there, they're getting rich while you're fooling around with it. And guess what? It's all about what? Foresight. I was listening to some studies yesterday and they said the average person now spends 2 hours every day flipping through pictures and jokes. Keep laughing at jokes. Keep laughing. You'll be laughing at 21, skip, you know, looking at jokes at 30. Then one day you realize you're 40 years old and you're still looking at the jokes. These are serious times here. You do not waste time on resources or waste anything when you have foresight. You know, many wise corporations, they all stopped expanding their high street operations quite a while back. Many of them had shut down all the high street locations, put everything online. They had foresight. They saw something. They knew something. Many changed their business plan at the beginning of this year. They started calling directors meetings and they started to say, okay, that business plan's crap. That lease, did we sign the lease yet? No, scrap that. Did we get that building yet? Scrap that. You know how much they've saved? By not paying any lease, not paying any electricity, gas. See, you work from home and you're happy, but you now work using your own gas bill and your own electricity bill. And you're still producing the same result and you're still getting, did they increase your salary? Mm-mm. And someone is no longer paying for security. Someone is no longer paying for anything in a building. And they tell you, you know, you can work in your garden if you like. You can just work in your bedroom if you like. Somebody say foresight. It's even so bad now that anyone who is going to go to university to go do a course, you really need to pray and find out whether what you're about to take, £50,000, £60,000 loan to study, will be useful by the time you come out. Somebody say foresight. Oh, I wish I had more time. I have questions for you, my kingdom citizens. Number one, with everything I've said to you now, how do you plan to secure your health in the near future? How do you plan to secure your health in 2021 in case there's a COVID-20 or a COVID-21? Foresight. You know, many of us Christians, you know what we did? We resorted to the place of saying, we don't have any solution. So we looked to the government and the scientists. And we waited at home and we've been hiding, waiting for vaccine. Many Christians are not even doing enough due diligence to even find out what is a vaccine. Some people don't even know what a vaccine is. Some people don't know a vaccine is an introduction of the same virus into your body. What they told you to mask yourself and wash your hand and do everything not to get, now they're saying come and get it. Many people do not even know. How many people know that in the history of all coronaviruses, SARS, H1N, there's never ever been a successful vaccine? How many people know that? Even Ebola, every single one of these epidemics has always gone by what's called herd immunity. Because the Lord God Almighty, who created the human being, created us with a natural ability to self-heal. God, in his infinite wisdom, puts something in every human being called antibodies. The antibodies work this way. When a virus comes into the body, it notices it, it fights it, and it eats it up. From how many thousands of years now since Genesis till now? There was no vaccine 2,000 years ago. How did they survive? How did they live? What is it that God has done? Don't get me wrong. Epidemics come. Don't get me wrong. Real viruses can kill. But I just want you to know that We should be seeking God to say, God, what is going on? So what if this vaccine puts some nanoparticles in you and then you become a robot? What if it changes your DNA structure? Because the mRNA vaccine has been clearly said it's a new technology. It's never been used before. And Pfizer have wisely gotten our government to sign to say nobody in the UK can sue them if anything goes wrong with it. That's one thing I know Americans would never do. Americans would never agree that they would lose the power to be able to sue. Now, I'm not, you know, somebody's watching this broadcast live. I'm not knocking vaccine. I'm just telling you that there's something better. Let's seek God. Is God still healing? Does God still have power to blow plagues away? Come on, Christians. Come on, believers. Does God still have power to blow plagues away? I don't know what's happened to us and our faith. Read your Bible. Every plague in the Bible came with God's agreement. And every single plague in the Bible went with God's declaration. The people were dying in the days of David. And David bought the land of Arunah, bought the land and went and brought a sacrifice before the Almighty God. And the plague that was killing people, David saw the angel with the sword up like that. And when God was pleased with the sacrifice, the plague ends. Plague is killing the people among the Hebrews. And Aaron and Moses begin to intercede. They are dying. I mean, talk about infectious plague. People are beginning to die in hundreds at the time. And they cried out to God. And God said, take the censer that is releasing my presence and run into the crowd. Aaron runs into the crowd of people. And where Aaron went, Aaron literally stopped all of the death. From that point on, nobody else gets the plague. Nobody else dies. Let me tell you something. A lot of us that claim to be Christians today, we need to get born again all over again because we don't have faith. We don't believe God anymore. Our God has been reduced too little that we have even exalted scientists over the Almighty God. And that is the reason why governments have no problem shutting down churches when we have pandemic. Because none of us are opening our mouth to boast about what God can do. So we're not that important. You go sit down somewhere. You're not essential services. None of us have dared to have the audacity to say we can pray for the people who are infected and they will be well. How do we think heaven is looking down at us right now? The cloud of witnesses, the martyrs, those who shed their blood to protect this gospel, those who died under the sword to protect the scriptures, they're looking now from the bleachers in heaven. And how are we currently doing? Never plan to say any of that, but how do you plan to secure your health in case of a new virus? If we depend on vaccine, then every year we need another 12 months for them to come up with another vaccine. So you go back into lockdown for the next virus. If I was the devil, what do you think I would do? If I was the devil, I've watched everything that happened in 2020. Do you think I would create a new virus per year? If I was the devil, I would give you a new one every February. Well, if your dependence is on scientists, then they work another 8 to 10 months to find another vaccine. I will ruin the life for mankind. All of you want to commit suicide. And then when you get the vaccine for the next one, I will start another one. Then you get the vaccine for that, I will start another one. You see, when God is no longer seen as being all-powerful to intervene and stop the hand of the enemy, then we are at the mercy of the devil and his demons. If they could get people to have the wrong heart to do stuff in the lab and mess with a strain of virus and create a new strain in the lab, then the devil can do it over and over and over again. And trust me, there are human beings on the face of the earth. If human beings can strap bomb around themselves and walk into the market to explode it, trust me, they will cooperate with the devil to create COVID-20. Somebody say, we need help.
Most importantly, we need foresight. What do you plan to do to secure your income? Oh, gosh. Oh, you got to bear with me. Just give me 10 more minutes. You've got to get this one. What do you plan to do to secure your income? Thank God for every one of us that have kept our job in 2020. But you dare not get overconfident. Some people were confident 3 months ago because they had a job with Debenhams. They're not confident anymore. You dare not get overconfident. They told you, you know, there's one of those lies that we believe. Oh, you're doing contract. I have a permanent. Power what? Who told you the job is permanent? Until the company needs to cut cost, then you'll find out that there's nothing like a permanent job. Everything is by faith. Speaking with a brother the other day who's been a contractor consulting for many, many years. We used to consult together. He said, I'm looking for a permanent job now. I said, well, he said, I need security. I just laughed. You better find security in God, because the same faith that brings contract is the same faith that brings permanent. Whether it's they call it permanent contract or even the person who signed 3 months who had faith. When 3 months ended, they gave six. When six ended, they gave 1 year. When 1 year, and the person who is saying permanent. My blood sister's been working contracts in the same company for 4.5 years now. Fantastic daily rate. 4.5 years, they just keep renewing it. Every time she calls me, say, oh, wow, in favor of God, they've renewed my contract again. And some people sign permanent contract and they didn't last 1 year. What are you going to do to secure your income in 2021? Have you reviewed your career to know whether it's going to become obsolete? Everybody that does customer service job in shops now, you need to probably rethink. Maybe it's time to go brush up your ability to be able to do customer service over the telephone. What should you change or do regarding investment? In our world here in the United Kingdom, many has already realized that they put all of their trust into the pension scheme and the money they were putting aside until they hit 65 and realized they couldn't retire, because if they retire, all they're going to get is £500 per month. So then at the age of 65, you now start applying for a job in Tesco to work as cashier. The reality is, what should you do now? How many of us children of God are watching what is changing in our world? Anybody watching what's happening with ETFs? How many people have ETFs? Hand up. Like I suspected, not too many hands. When I said Warren Buffett moved his investment into precious metals, how many people know how much an ounce of gold is right now in the UK? When the market closed this weekend, it was 1,390. It lost 10 pounds in the last 4 days. How many people know how much an ounce of silver is worth? Do you know the reason why they're buying gold? Do you know when the price of gold goes up? The price of gold goes up when people lose confidence in fiat money. How many Christians even understand the principle of money? When people hear that fiat money is going to fail, do you know many Christians don't understand what it means? Most people don't even know how fiat money came. If I say this expression, gold and silver is God's money, crypto is the people's money. Do you know what I mean by that? Right now in America, it is said that 20% of the money in circulation in America was printed this year. Now, do you know what that means to each US dollar? It has been devalued significantly. And you know what that always means? Inflation. When there's more of the paper in circulation and still the same amount of goods, then the price of the goods will have to go up. The law of demand and supply. Children of God, we have to become wise. I'm not a financial advisor. As a matter of fact, most of the regular financial advisors, lately I've had the opportunity of sitting down while they've tried to give advice to one or two people, and I just realized, hell no, none of you guys can advise me right now, because you're not with the times. Anybody still telling you now, you know, just spread it and buy bonds, you know, how old are you? Okay, you put about 40% in bonds and 60% in, that one is old-fashioned advice. I cleared out every bond I had in about a week ago. I cleared it out. You've got to go with the times. What is this? Just somebody, if you know what this is, just shout out. Tell me you know what this is. Does anybody know what this is? Not Pastor Ruth. Anybody? Anybody else know what this is? What is it? Somebody? You were in the first service. Doesn't count. That's a Ledger Nano X. This is what you call a hardware wallet for crypto. You store your unique address information so that no one can get hold of it if you leave it on the open market. I had to begin to re-educate myself. I had to educate myself to understand what cryptocurrency is. See, I'd spoken carelessly in time past until I began to realize that, wait a minute, foresight. My friend, Prophet Jacob John, over a year ago, I remember he called me aside one day and said, friend, you've got to understand crypto. Because prophetically, what is about to happen? See your money in your bank? It's already failing. Be careful. It's already failing. You know what interest rate is right now? Anybody Bank of England interest rate? We're so close to zero, there's only one way to go, minus. Do you know they've been talking about it, the possibility of a negative interest rate? Do you know what that means? It means you could keep £1,000 in the bank, but if you say you want to get it, they'll say, well, you can't get all of it. If you're going to get your £1,000, you want to make the withdrawal, you have to settle for £950 because we have negative interest rate. How are you preparing, my brothers and sisters? Who knows the price of crypto today? Somebody should have asked me, which one? Someone should have said, which one? All right, who knows the price of Bitcoin? Roughly 19K. Do you know how much one Bitcoin used to be? Do you know how come many people have become millionaires while you were getting a second job and working many more hours? Even gold, it was about $1,000 for an ounce early this year. That is now £1,400 for an ounce. Even gold. Gold coins, ounce coin. Knowing, understanding which one is more valuable, which one is more available, knowing the reason why do you buy coin rather than bar. There's so many of these things, my brothers and sisters, we have to educate ourselves. Traditional stuff, go and ask Debenhams. I'm rounding this thing up because of time. Ultimately, according to Jeremiah chapter 29, Jeremiah said, for I know the thoughts that I have towards you, says the Lord. This is God speaking to his children while they were in captivity. In verse 11, he said, I know the plans that I have towards you. And then Jeremiah now goes on prophesying the word of the Lord to the people. And then he tells them in verse 12, he said, then you will call upon me and you will go and you will pray to me and I would listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. Please write down Jeremiah chapter 33 verse 3. I'm rounding up now. Jeremiah 33 verse 3. Listen to the word of God, the prophetic declaration of God. He says, call to me and I will answer you and I will show you great and mighty things you do not know. Somebody say, God knows everything. If you seek him, he will show you. Can I beg every child of God in this season? Let all laziness with prayer life cease. Laziness in prayer life is going to cost you in this world that we live in now. Every one of us must now have our own journals that we take into prayer. Learn how to pray to God and prepare questions. Father, what should I do? This £5,000 that I have, Lord, what should I do with it? Not just trusting man, going to prayer and kneel down and cry out to God. Maybe God will say, boy, go learn about Ethereum. Maybe he's going to say, go learn. Because he knows all things. You know, one of the things I discovered, most wealth is created between 9 o'clock and 9:30 on certain days of the year. You know what's unique about those days? They're the days of IPOs. The days of IPOs. The key is most of us, we get the crumbs. We go buy the stock after. But what it takes to have the inside information, to get in on it, because on IPO day, some have gone up 1,500% in half an hour. So the rich keep getting richer because they're smart. But the poor keep working harder and staying poor because we're not. One day, within 30 minutes, many millionaires are made because somebody gave them a tip. Buy this. It's going to go IPO on this day. Market opens 30 minutes later. Some have gone 2,000%. And then they're laughing. They put $1,000 into something and they walk away with $300,000 in one day. Then the rest of the people, Joneses, come afterwards and then they buy it. I was listening to the guy who was the one that tipped everybody about bitcoins. He was also the one that gave tips on most of the top tech companies before the day of their IPO. He used to work as an investor specialist for companies, but one day he just said he felt God was saying, you need to help other people. He's already wealthy. He's made many people billionaires, but he just has a passion now to help people who are struggling get some wisdom on how the rich get rich. I'm not going to tell you his name. Believe that God wants you to have foresight. Believe God's prophetic word and his kingdom agenda. Be willing to warfare for the word from God. Be willing to pay the price to develop your spiritual senses. Hebrews chapter 5 talks about it, verse 14. By the reason of use, we develop our senses. God is always speaking. The question is, who is listening? Let's rise up together. One more scripture. Revelation chapter 4, verse 1. All the Kingdom Faith Ministry students are supposed to be reading the book of Revelation now. Let me tell you something ahead of time, because I know I've heard from God about this. When I share the vision for our church for 2021, one of the things you're going to notice is that our Bible reading for 2021 is going to be very unusual. In 2021, all we're going to read is prophecy. In 2021, the Lord spoke to my heart clearly, said, my children now need to become aware of how to understand prophetic words that I have declared in time past, and so we can understand when they begin to unfold. So we have to become students of the prophetic. That is what foresight is all about. God speaks to John while John is on the island of Patmos, and he gives him a spiritual vision, and he said, come up here, for I will show you the things that are to come. And we see all the events he saw in heaven that is documented in the book of Revelation. God showed it to John 2,000 years ago. Many of those events are just unfolding before our eyes. Remember, I told you last week, Revelation 13, about the mark of the beast and a system that would determine who will be able to buy or sell. John saw it 2,000 years ago. Can we respond to God in prayer this morning? I just want to encourage you, my brothers and sisters. Would you close your eyes for a moment?